It's interesting that this new book has just come out as I've been rereading The Intelligent Investor, written by Ben Graham 62 years ago. In his new book, The Einstein of Money, The Life and Timeless Financial Wisdom of Ben Graham, author Joe Carlin gets into his personal life a little, but most importantly, he discusses the ideas which Warren Buffett said about Ben Graham, that no one ever became poor by reading Graham. Of course, Warren Buffett repeatedly acknowledged Ben Graham as a man he personally studied with and worked under as a primary influence on his investment approach. Let's find out more about this book. So, the book is The Einstein of Money, The Life and Timeless Financial Wisdom of Benjamin Graham. Welcome to the show, Joe.
Thank you. Thanks for having me on.
So let's get into what was different about Ben Graham. How did Ben Graham change the investment world like Einstein changed the world of science?
Well, he, just like Einstein, he constructed a new paradigm with which to look at, just like Einstein constructed a new paradigm with which to look at the physical universe, Graham did so for the universe, if you will, of investment finance.
What was the universe like before? What was the Newtonian universe of investments like before Graham?
Well, with a few exceptions in the pre-World War I era, definitely in the post-World War I era, it was focused almost entirely on the technical chart, essentially on short-term market momentum. So where's the price going to head to, you know, tomorrow?
Mm-hmm.
And with little regard for the underlying fundamentals of the issuing company.
But there was a long investing history prior to World War II, right? I mean,
World War I, yeah.
World War I as well. But I mean, as far as public markets are concerned, the, you know, companies, railroad companies were public. They sold stock, they sold bonds, and fortunes were made, I think, in a sense, mostly by speculators way back when. But define that environment of investing, you know, prior to the security analysis industry that has grown up today.
So essentially, the focus was on how can we analyze the movements and then anticipate where it might be within a relatively short time frame and then get in and out and time the market. And then Graham, particularly, I mean, he began working on Wall Street in 1914, but particularly in the 20s, he noticed how that strategy was basically like a roulette wheel, because you were right just as often as you were wrong, and there seemed to be no empirical basis for any decision-making.
Mm-hmm.
And being a mathematics major at Columbia and just being a very logically inclined sort of person, he said, you know, there has to be a more empirical way to invest. And so he said, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to ignore the market noise or miss the market. I'm just going to ignore that temporarily, and I'm going to go just do my own homework and look at this company as a whole and evaluate it. Evaluate its earnings, evaluate its capital position, and so forth. And then I'm going to arrive at a per-share value. Then I'm going to look at what the market's pricing it at, and then from there I'm going to make a decision.
Was he a particularly conservative individual? I mean, there's two lives here to Ben Graham, the personal life and then his professional life. And I don't really want to get into the personal life except to say with this question, was he conservative in his personal life?
Well, in some ways, especially for that time, he was fairly wild, certainly his romantic life, and some of his views, his agnostic views. So he was certainly not traditional in much of his thinking and much of his behavior.
Mm-hmm.
But when it came to investment, he was extraordinarily conservative, and there were a number of reasons for that.
What were they?
The primary one would be he had a riches-to-rags childhood in which his father, who was running a large import business of kitchenware called Grossbaum & Sons. His father died very early at age 35, and the entire business collapsed, and it was once extremely successful. So his family just fell into deeper and deeper poverty, and he really began to appreciate that actually forced him to be conservative, because he was the one assigned to go do shopping on a very tight budget and various other experiences during that time that really forced him to be conservative and to look for value, to look for 50-cent dollars, which, of course, is the essence of value investing.
I'm speaking with Joe Carlin. He's the author of The Einstein of Money, The Life and Timeless Financial Wisdom of Ben Graham. Ben Graham, of course, was the mentor, teacher of Warren Buffett and so many of the other value-based investors who are still around today. So he came in with a strong mathematical background. He had a business background, and because of his personal life, he was particularly conservative. And so how did he use those qualities specifically to formulate his investment strategies?
Well, he learned to sort of strip away the artifice, to strip away the appearances, the surface level appearances, because he knew that they often were meaningless. And he learned that the market price itself could, in fact, be very misleading metric. And he even more so, even going a step further, he even learned to disregard the opinion of other analysts to a large extent.
Mm-hmm.
And what he was mainly interested in was the original data, so the financial statements, balance sheet and income statement. And in those days, actually, it was much harder to come by the full financial data. But anyway, he believed, even though there's potential for manipulation even in the original data, that at least was the most reliable source of data.
Mm-hmm.
And he learned actually how to detect when there was manipulation. So he learned to look at the original data and then from there form his own conclusions as to the soundness of earnings and the soundness of the capital position, so whether or not a company had excessive debt. And looking at various metrics, he learned how to reduce his risk as much as possible every time he purchased a security.
You know, you bring up an interesting point that before, I don't know the year, but the SEC had changed the rules, whereas before companies didn't have to report any of their private financial data. As a matter of fact, I read somewhere that if you went and asked them, they would often, you know, tell you to get the heck out of here because it's none of your business, even though you're a shareholder. But that all changed when the SEC changed the rules. And he was really the first person to kind of see that and take that information and formulate these investment strategies. From what I understand as well, he also started looking at business, looking at investing in stocks, shares of companies, and looking at it as if you were investors, as you were a business owner. It's a different point of view. And I know Buffett talks about this all the time. When he goes to buy a company, he thinks of himself as the, what if he was the owner of 100% of the company? You want to take a moment to talk about that?
Yeah, and what's interesting is that Buffett started with that philosophy, and now, as it turns out, he is 100% owner of,
yeah,
of a number of companies,
it's
like
true.
Geico, for example.
Right, right.
But the central premise there is that Graham noticed that when private business owners were looking to, you know, purchase, you know, let's say a restaurant or a cotton mill, whatever it might be, they would look very carefully at the past earnings and the debt levels and so forth, and from there make a decision as to what it was worth. But then what happened was in the 20s, with the beginning of the sort of mass retail investor phenomenon where many investors were not business people, what would happen is it created an opportunity for people to inject a lot of hyperbole into, you know, what a company is really worth or so forth. So he says, you know, look at it as if, you know, don't, you know, dabble in a share here, a couple shares there. Look at the entire company and just consider, you know, hypothetically that you have, you know, $300 billion to buy all of Merck or whatever it might be. And then look at the company and see, okay, so now the market price of Merck is, let's say, $500 billion, and you decide that its real value is $700 billion. Therefore, it would make sense, hypothetically, to buy the entire company. So therefore, if it makes sense to buy the entire company, it makes sense to buy one share or 100 shares or whatever you're considering.
You know, today's markets seem quite treacherous. Were markets of Graham's day any less so or more so?
Not at all. I mean, he lived to see a number of cycles, and he was actively in the market for 42 years, and he was still an astute observer of the market for another 20. And he saw the same patterns repeat themselves over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, it was the same pattern of excessive greed followed by excessive fear, and he formulated a way of profiting from that.
I'm vastly interested in this idea of figuring out what companies are really worth, because there seem to be so many variables. You mentioned how much debt a company has, how much capital it has on the books, what its book value is per se. And yet it's even more complicated than that. How did Ben Graham value a company so that he would know whether the purchase of a company was a smart thing to do, because he would be paying under what the intrinsic value is? How did he know that?
Well, primarily he was looking at what is the future value of the cash flows that will be generated from this business on a per-share basis. So he was primarily using a discount cash flow model. But there was more to it than that, because he also had some very rigorous screens for safety. So he wouldn't just look at the value, he would also consider how safe the company was. And in that regard, he would look at the stability of earnings, the dividend record, even just how large the company was, because the company might be doing very well for a number of years, but it might be relatively small and then more vulnerable to some unforeseen change in the industry. So, there were two parts to his analysis, the looking at the per share value and also screening for safety.
You mentioned this word safety. I want to address that for a second because I don't know if he invented the term, but a term that has come to be quite associated with him is this term margin of safety. Before you invest, make sure you have a wide margin of safety. What is that and why is that so important under Graham's thoughts?
Sure. So the essence of that is that if according to your analysis, the per share value of ABC Inc. is $70 and it's currently selling for $65, that $5 margin of safety, or that, less than 10% margin of safety in this case, he probably wouldn't consider that a sufficient margin of safety. So he would prefer much wider margins because essentially he knew that the markets on a day-to-day level were unpredictable, but over the long term, the market would correct its large mistakes. A scenario that I highlight in the book is that in 2008, Harley-Davidson had a earnings report that was somewhat disappointing, but they were still very profitable. They just got hammered. I mean, the stock was hammered by over 60%.
Right.
Buffett sweeps in, buys a large block of Harley-Davidson, and sure enough, the market eventually recognized its mistake, and it came back to its usual. Because Buffett knew that he was buying at a large margin of safety. He knew that the market had overreacted tremendously to some short-term bad news that it really wasn't even that bad. So those were the kinds of opportunities that Buffett would look for as well, and perhaps his most famous margin of safety purchase was his company's half purchase of Geico.
Also the Washington Post. I mean, I believe that was valued at...
Graham's half purchase of Geico
of
in the late
Geico,
40s,
Before
anyone even knew who it was. But with regards to Buffett, the Washington Post was another famous one.
Well, tell us briefly about the Graham purchase of Geico.
Sure. So this is really fascinating. In the late 1940s, the Geico opportunity was shopped around to a bunch of different Wall Street houses, and the Graham Newman Corporation, which was Graham's partnership. So all these other Wall Street houses turned it down, including many that were larger than Graham's company. And Graham looked at it, and he saw that it was a very cheap price for the value, and it was a very strong business, very conservatively run business, regular cash flow, and of course insurance is the way that company was run was very predictable cash flow. But it was selling at a cheap price because the insurance industry was not the flavor of the month on Wall Street.
Mm-hmm.
So Graham capitalized on that. And that is an investment that paid him back over 200 times.
Wow.
And then, of course, in the 70s, the same thing happened with Geico. It fell out of favor with the market. And Buffett swept in and bought a huge start. I mean, he actually had been buying since the early 50s because he was watching what Graham was doing. And then he bought much more in the 70s, and he kept buying. And now, of course, his holding company owns it outright.
Right.
So that was just a classic example of Graham's methods and the kind of home runs that can be hit.
The book is The Einstein of Money, The Life and Timeless Financial Wisdom of Ben Graham. Let me also say that, talking about Warren Buffett, and the Washington Post. I think Washington Post in the early 70s was valued at, intrinsic value was around $500 million. I think that Buffett picked it up for significantly less than $100 million. And, times were tough for the newspaper business back then. There were a lot of strikes and so on. But, he was looking at cash flow. He was looking at the intrinsic value. And, Joe, what's interesting is that the opportunities abound today. I mean, we see every single day companies that miss their earnings reports that take 10, 20, 30% haircuts in value that day. And someone's got to be in there that understands the intrinsic value of the business, that says, what would I get as a owner of this whole business, compares it to the current price because investors, are, what did you say, the flavor of the day. And sure enough, you've got great value investors coming in today. Do you see any difference today in terms of opportunities than Graham or Buffett experienced 40, 50, 60 years ago?
No, I mean, I'd say the biggest difference is that it's actually much easier, much quicker to run the stats. And there's also a much larger landscape of investing. It's much easier to invest in foreign securities, and many of the foreign markets are much safer than they were back in Graham's time. So if anything, it's just the larger playing field.
Well, thank you so much, my guest, Joe Carlin, the Einstein of money, the life and timeless financial wisdom of Ben Graham. If you have any interest in this subject, this is a great book for you to get. And alongside, as your bedside reading companion, you should also read The Intelligent Investor. Thanks, Joe. Really appreciate you spending some time with us.
Thank you.